Good morning to you.
Good morning.
Very happy to see so many curious minds turn up on a weekend. So we're all here to learn, right? So about me, I am Jay Kumar. People call me as Jay. So I head this continuous verification platform, OpsMx. We'll talk about that in the later part of the session. As a company, we exist for the past 3 years, right? And when you think about the offerings, primarily this company was built on top of a tool called Spinnakar. So as you know, enterprises moving away from a single cloud vendor to multi-cloud vendor. And when you talk about which is the single platform which can do your orchestration service across the clouds, Spinnakar becoming a de facto choice. So open source software supported by a large community of open source developers contributing to it. And we are also a major part of it in developing and making the systems stable. We also have our enterprise customers. We have something called Open Enterprise Spinnakar. Primarily, this is like on top of the vanilla Spinnakar, we built our own value-add services. What it will do is it will help you to easily onboard your applications onto the Spinnakar platform in a hassle-free manner. We also have this continuous verification platform which is built on top of machine learning and AI technologies, which can be seamlessly integrated into the CI/CD pipeline. So I'll briefly talk about it going forward. So in addition, the OES supports your security concerns, your monitoring and other compliance features. So the second part is the autopilot. That's the name for our continuous verification platform. It is built in such a way, so as I told you, this can be plugged into your CI/CD pipeline in a seamless way. Either you are using Spinnakar as your CI/CD pipeline or Jenkins, or you can have your own custom build script. So we have option which can plug into it, and you can make an automated decision to move it to production, or you can have a manual verification to make a choice whether it's good to go or not. Autopilot is built in such a way it can work with the popular technologies or the tools already in the market. Like be it for log storage, we have the Elasticsearch, which becomes the de facto popular one. And we also have the Sumo Logic. And when you talk about the metrics, we support Prometheus, Neuralink, or Datadog, and the support is growing day by day. So our primary focus is on the medium to large enterprises, right? Because we are looking at there are customers who the traditional ways of software development lifecycle is gone. People are doing like multiple releases per day, if not per hour, right? So for them, they cannot no more rely on the traditional way of having a build cycle, unit testing cycle, or verification cycle. By the time, the competition might have gone ahead, right? So you need to make a high velocity release with high confidence. So you need some innovation in this place, right? That's where our software and tools will come in handy. And we are funded by the top VCs. The Foundation Capital is well known, and Dell Technologies Capital is another VC for us. When you talk about the employees, in these 3 years we have scaled. Like we are 50 plus as of now and actively growing. And our management is based out of US, but primary engineering is delivered from India. Like we have a major team in Hyderabad and another team in Bangalore. So we have very experienced team. Like people are veterans from the industry. Like Netflix is the, for the people who do not know, like Netflix is the original author of Spinnakar, right? So the beauty about Netflix is it's not a traditional IT company. So there is no bias towards like supporting one vendor or promoting something else. They invented it for their own survival, right? And once they proven value and find value in it, they thought like the best way to scale is to open it up, right? And it's like that is what we are all here, right? We are not talking about in the boardrooms like how to do the roadmap and other things. Just open it up, and the fear of what if somebody takes my idea and copy, that is gone, right? Like you open it up, and there is always a scope and room for everybody to take a pie out of it. So we have veterans joining from that company, AWS and Cisco. So like we have a very strong foundation management team and a very capable engineering team to deliver it. So even though like autopilot is one of the offerings, today we are all here to learn about Spinnakar and to take that further in the session. I'd like to hand over the session to my colleague Anoop. Hello everybody.
Good morning. I'm Anoop Jaya. I'm a senior DevOps engineer at OpsMx. So I'd like to thank you all to making it to coming down and listen to us during the weekend. So today's agenda, I'm gonna introduce you to Spinnakar, and I have a short live demo wherein I'll be walking you through the pipeline that I've developed with Kubernetes, which will promote the code to the production deployment. And at the end of the session, we'll go ahead with the Q&A. So to start with, why Spinnakar, and what big difference does Spinnakar make compared to the other continuous delivery platforms? So Spinnakar is already proven and scalable, and it's used by many organizations, and in Netflix itself, on a day-to-day basis, there are around 6,000 to 7,000 plus deployments actively running using Spinnakar. And we from OpsMx, we are supporting Cisco already. And in Cisco, on a weekly basis, there are around 5,000 plus build and deployment activities happening on the Cisco environment using Spinnakar. And there are built-in best practices, which I'll explain you in detail, like what are the best practices that we follow using Spinnakar. And we have an active community in Spinnakar. Like for example, to give you a channel, so we have a Spinnakar Slack. If you log into the Spinnakar IO website, you have the Spinnakar Slack, which you can get the invite and log into the Slack. There are active discussions happening around on all the issues users are facing, and we from OpsMx, we contribute, and not only OpsMx, there are random users who contribute on Spinnakar issues very actively. And it is not only the Spinnakar Slack, but also there is Stack Overflow and GitHub, so issues are flowing around. And the current contributors from globally for Spinnakar is, as Jay already mentioned, Netflix has developed Spinnakar, but it is backed by major tech giants like Google, Microsoft, Pivotal. And now we, OpsMx, are also contributing to Spinnakar development. So what is Spinnakar for most of you who are not familiar with this? So Spinnakar is a continuous delivery platform, which is open source by Netflix. And in Spinnakar, there are a couple of advantages. For example, multi-cloud is one of the best feature. Like it supports multiple cloud providers like Kubernetes, AWS, OpenShift, OpenStack, and so on. So it kind of, the list is pretty big. But when compared to the when coming to the deployment cycle, it supports almost all of the cloud providers that is currently available in the industry. And the release strategies in Spinnakar is it is already said that it's a safe release strategies. So yes, there are safe release strategies. For example, blue green deployments, which is also called as a red black otherwise. So with blue green, the main advantage here is it allows users to deploy the code without terminating the previous version of deployment. And while executing the blue-green deployment, the other main thing is when the deployment has happened, Spinnakar will take care of shifting the traffic to the latest version. And once the deployment is done, all the entire request from the previous deployment to the latest deployment will be shifted by Spinnakar. And once, if your deployment is if it is successful, then there is one more stage which we can add up for manual judgment, which can proceed with the further deployments. Or else, if you think that there is some of your bugs open or some of your issues are still not yet resolved, you can just cancel the deployment, and again Spinnakar will take care of automated rollback. So what happens in this cycle is, if you prefer to cancel this deployment, the current deployment will roll back to the previous version, and your UI on the production. So this is applicable on the production. If you are preferring to staging, on the staging, it will still stay back with the current version, because the testing process will start from the staging, so it will stick to the same the latest version on the staging. But the other environments like UAT, SIT, and all that, on all other environments, the rollback will get executed, and it will be rolled back without any data loss. So that's one of the feature, and Canary deployments and rolling updates. So Canary deployments, using Canary deployment strategy, you can make your deployments, and also you can capture the metrics of your deployments, end-to-end metrics, like whether your deployment is successfully done, and after the deployment is done, who exactly is deployed. So this Canary deployment also meets your compliance of our organization, of the requirements of how you want. So it also takes care of the compliance part. And we have something called templates. So this templates is nothing but the pipelines you create. For example, let's talk about Jenkins for the time being. So in Jenkins, if we create any pipelines, each and every pipeline has multiple scripts integrated into that. So in Spinnakar, there is no such dependency. Within the Spinnakar, there are drop-downs for each and every stage that you want to select. And once your pipeline is selected and it's functioning properly, you can convert that pipeline into a template. If you are preferring to replicate that pipeline into multiple environments, or if you are trying to create that pipeline for other use cases, all you need to do is execute this pipeline and create a pipeline using the same template. There are some minor changes which you need to do, like selecting your application and etc. But it can be controlled with that. And pipeline as a code is another feature. So Spinnakar also comes with a command line interface. With that command line interface, you can control your pipeline as a code. So that is also one feature available. And role-based access. So most of us, we always prefer to have compliant-proven UI or access to be given to our team members. So with this role-based access feature, Spinnakar does support role-based access feature. So with this, basically you can control users to deploy within their own environments, and they'll not be able to go beyond their deployment. They'll not be able to go beyond their access. If a developer is trying to deploy, he'll only be able to deploy in development and staging environments, nothing more than that. So with Chaos Monkeys integration, resiliency test in production is straightforward, and it's proven we have proven results from Netflix and Google right now, that using Chaos Monkey integration, the testing results are pretty accurate, and it's almost 99.6% accurate results that we have received, and each and everything is a successful deployment that we have got over there. Automated risk analysis and automated candy analysis, both are pretty much the same, which we have discussed here, wherein we'll be capturing the metrics of all of the deployments and getting the audit details of the releases, failures, and in automated risk analysis, there is one more thing which we can integrate, as Jay mentioned, our autopilot product. So we can integrate that, which will also take care of log analysis using our the code that we have integrated for the autopilot. Policy rules and engines. So this is to support the compliance for enterprise organizations. Basically, from the policy rules and engines, we can bifurcate not only the pipeline access, but also the application access. In the Spinnakar UI, there is one single UI for Spinnakar, so that is one advantage. Again, when you're doing a deployment, you don't have to move between multiple UIs. It is all you have to do is just log into Spinnakar and check out your pipeline details. All the data validations, everything can be done from one single UI, and in fact, when your container is getting deployed, You don't even have to get back to the back end through the command line. You don't even have to look at the replica assets, whether if it is deployed properly or not. All of the information is available on the UI. If there is any failure under the infrastructure, you can see the failure results. If all the deployments are done successfully, the load balancers, the infrastructures, how the load balancer traffic is happening, everything is shown in the UI. So there are a couple of core features in Spinnakar, but I'm highlighting the major features. Like one is the immutable server-based design. So I guess most of you are already aware, like, what is the immutable server base. This is basically, it does, you know, once your deployment is done, and if you try to make any changes to the deployment, it's not possible. It doesn't allow you to make any changes. You need to get back to your host or the container, make the changes over there, tear down the current deployment, and make this deployment applicable from the scratch again. So, with immutable infrastructure, many organizations, from Cisco, we have a feedback right now. So with immutable infrastructure, the deployment, they are using their build, testing, validation, and the deployment cycle is very much deterministic. So it's accurate and risk-free. I don't say completely risk-free, but at least there is a low-risk deployment. And safe deployment strategies, we have spoken about this, canary, blue-green, and rolling update. But with the latest version of Spinnakar, there are a few more features which we are currently testing right now on the deployment strategies. So once we are done, all of these details, all of the latest features will be available on our blogs on opsmx.com. So you can definitely visit and check out our blogs. Integration with enterprise continuous integration and other tools. So Spinnakar supports almost all the CI tools available on the market right now, but there are some limitations. But right now we are it's totally certified with Jenkins and Travis, and also if you are planning to integrate your Kubernetes jobs with Spinnakar, that is also supported. Like any Kubernetes jobs that you have, you can integrate that with Spinnakar directly, and when you integrate that. So basically, Kubernetes jobs integrating with Spinnakar, it helps you to make a compliance. Again, everything that we are, most of the features that we are talking about, it is to ensure that your deployments are safe, and there is no biasing basically. So it is compliant friendly. So with that, I'll move on to the next slide. So how does Spinnakar add value? Right now, if we talk about the current continuous delivery method that is happening, right? Let's for example, consider Jenkins. So if we give an access to the development team and they try to execute the pipeline, so basically, we either have to give the pipeline access completely, or else we need to provide some access wherein they can make some changes to the pipeline and all that. So with Spinnakar, all you have to do is they don't even need any edit access to the pipeline. For developers, it is easy to onboard and deploy their applications. All they have to do, once they commit the code in the GitHub, there is a GitHub trigger option available. Once if the developer commits the code, he doesn't even have to log into the Spinnakar UI. The deployment will be taken forward, and the deployment will be carried forward without even logging into the console. And manage pipelines as code, as I've just mentioned in the previous slide. So pipelines can be, there is an edit section for each and every pipeline wherein you can capture the live code of your particular pipeline that you have, and you can manage the code within the pipeline. Like if you want to make any changes from the backend rather than going it from the UI using Spin CLI, you can make all of the changes directly from your terminal. and customize with simple extensions. So each and every option that you have in Spinnakar, it is declarative. So basically, if you need to add a stage and if you prefer to modify any stages, for example, you're trying to deploy a manifest, your Kubernetes manifest available. So you can select the deploy stage. Spinnakar supports both versions, V1 and V2 Kubernetes. So if you choose manifest deployment and if you want to deploy a manifest based deployment, all you need to do, add a stage. Everything can be added as per your own requirement. And visibility and diagnostics, as I've mentioned to you, everything, each and every task while your pipeline is getting executed, the task status, if there is a build calling up in the backend, even that, for that also, you don't have to get back to the Jenkins. It can be viewed from the Spinnakar UI. And once the build is completed, it will show the complete stage, and then it will move forward to the next stage. As I have mentioned, customize and declarative, both are pretty much the same. And coming to the operations team, best practice templates, that is the pipeline templates that I've spoke about, and manual judgments is the this is something which I'd like to highlight more about. So manual judgment is, we mostly use manual judgments in Spinnakar to avoid any risk in the production deployments. So that is one of the main reason why manual judgment is here. There is auto judgment also, but this is more recommended because if there are any minor issues, or if the, for example, there are scenarios where the container is being pulled, but the deployment is not happening properly, and this caused a downtime on the production. So to avoid any such issues, we can use the manual judgment, wherein if all the lower environments deployments are successful, it will send a notification to any particular user. So that will be taken care by the role-based access. So it will send a notification to the user, and that user, once if he approves, and for that approval also, he has a list of things that he need to take care of. So once he approves, only then the deployment will proceed further to production. And when it is coming to production deployment again, the best practice that is suggested is, while adding a production stage, it is always suggested to create a new pipeline for production deployment, because in the same stage, in one single pipeline, if you add up both, if you add up all your development stages to the prod stages, so basically there are high chances of the deployment getting continuously running without any approvals. So that is the reason we call up for a different pipeline altogether to execute the prod deployment. And I spoke about rollbacks already, which is automated rollback. I'll show you in the demo. So some of the highlights of features that Spinnakar supports for Kubernetes. So Spinnakar supports native manifest approach, which Kubernetes supports, and also it supports the Helm charts for deployments. Start from the Spinnakar installation, the deployment that you do in the Spinnakar, everything can be carried forward by the Helm charts. If you prefer not to use the UI, everything can be taken forward by the Helm charts. Artifact binding is for the, in case if you are not using Helm-based deployments, you can go ahead and use artifact deployments, artifact binding, which will take care of your, both of these, it will take care of from the scratch, from your Spinnakar installation till the deployment cycle, your pipeline management, basically everything can be taken care of, Helm charts and the artifact binding. And Spinnakar was certified with early Kubernetes because of the limitations with all other platforms, but right now Spinnakar supports all of the Kubernetes flavors, GKE, EKS, PKS, OpenShift, and Kubernetes. But anyway, I guess most of you are already aware that each and every of these technologies have, of these platforms have their own differences. For example, I think OpenShift, it supports deployment config, which is not as popular. But whereas in Kubernetes, it is totally different. And Kubernetes supports ingress. And in OpenShift, it is route-based for all the ingress values. So those differences are always there, but still your deployments can be carried forward using any flavor of EKS, Kubernetes, And coming to the permissions, so you can assign your Spinnakar installation for a complete Kubernetes cluster if you prefer to share the Spinnakar for your organization wide. Or else there is always a namespace option. You can create a namespace, create different Spinnakers for multiple teams according to your requirement, or else one Spinnaker with multiple rollback access. So that is always there. And Istio is also integrated with Spinnaker. And what we are doing with Istio here is we do a traffic shaping for all the releases. Like for example, in one latest, So in a latest release, if you have two versions of releases going on, you can define the load based upon your requirement. So like if you want to pass on 10% of the load to the V2, and if you want to pass 90% of the V1, Istio can take care of the traffic shaping. But the rest of the things can be handled by Spinnaker. And now I'll walk you through the product demo. So this is the Spinnaker UI, and we have multiple links here, so search options, projects, and the one which I have mentioned, pipeline templates. So from this pipeline templates, you can just click on pipeline templates and replicate any pipeline that you have active on your Spinnaker. So today I am going to give you a demo with our multi-cloud demo. And as I've mentioned, one single UI shows up everything. So these are the pipelines that I have. And in my pipelines, in this multi-cloud demo, I already have an AWS pipeline, which basically creates a EC2 instance and deploys my product into this. And I have a Kubernetes pipeline. What this does is, it just takes all the artifacts, builds it, and makes the deployments. So in short, I'll just walk you through how these pipelines are created. So before executing the pipeline, I'd also like to show you the infrastructure part here. So when you do the deployment, any latest deployments that you execute, as I've mentioned, if your container is getting created, you don't have to get to the terminal to check your container details. All of the details are available in the clusters here. So in my scenario, right now, as I'm going to show you a demo of Kubernetes. So these are my Kubernetes demo, Kubernetes containers that is available, and all of these containers are created in the server. So to check the deployment, whether if it is active or not, you can directly check it from here. And if you click on the container, you have all of the details, like how this is being accessed. So in this, you have the replica set actions, what are the replica sets, and to which namespace it is assigned. So basically, everything is available on the same screen. And load balancers. So this is where you can find the load balancers assigned to these particular deployments, the current deployments that is active on the Spinnaker. So on production, I only have one deployment because I am using a blue-green deployment stage right now. And whenever I do a deployment, my old deployment will be deleted, and I'll only have one deployment active on the production. But this is the staging part, so I have multiple active load balancers here. So to execute the pipeline also, we have two if you prefer to execute the pipeline manually, there is start manual execution option. But right now, since I have trigger enabled, I don't want to execute it manually. I'll just make a small change to my, I have deployed a sample application, sample application which we developed in-house, and it is pretty cute. So. This is my sample application which has pet store in it. So right now all I'm going to do is I'm going to change the background of my app. So right now I have the background as green color, but I'm going to change it to blue, and then I'll just commit the code quickly. So once the commit is done, it should automatically trigger the pipeline that I'm using for Kubernetes here. While the pipeline is getting executed, I'll walk you through like what all configurations is given, is provided in the pipeline. My commit is done right now, so let's go and check whether if the pipeline is executing. So yeah, there you go. So the pipeline is started right now, and the execution details, this is the source that it is collecting the artifacts from, and you can see the execution details over here. So Jenkins config, and if you look at the task status, so all of the task status is available right now. Build properties is getting executed. So while this is happening, I'll quickly walk through the pipeline. This we are running out of time. So this is the pipeline that I have, and I have multiple stages here. Configuration is where I define all my GitHub details, from where the artifacts need to be collected and all of that. And build is the Jenkins details. So where will this Jenkins details be captured from? So while installing Spinnakar, there is configuration. There are parameters that needs to be configured. So all of those are available in a huge documentation that is available on the website, on how to configure Jenkins, on what all of the configuration steps. So here, if you look at the dropdown, there is the master, Jenkins master, and the repository that I'm choosing to. So all of the details are present here under the configuration section. And the deployment stage that I'm using is the account. I choose the account that I have. So to set this account also, there is a process that we need to execute. So that is also available in the documentation. And I'm using a simple manifest again, which is calling my container from the GitHub, and the spec details for the my port, the name of the application. So basically, a simple manifest to assign my image. And the next phase is a test suite. So which basically auto executes a test on the staging environment, which calls my application IP address and the port number. And it will just access the UI. It will try to see whether if the latest release is completely deployed or not. If the deployment has failed, or if the latest changes are not showing up, it will by default show a failed status under this testing screen. And this verify stage is the manual judgment that I was talking about, wherein we give a conditional, we give the judgment inputs over here, like if the deployment is success or fail, and that is when if the deployment is success, it proceeds to the prod deployment. If the deployment is failure, if it just rolls back and stays on with the current deployment state. So right now the deployment is done, and so this is the latest version that is being deployed. 329 is the latest version, and if I the judgment input is available here. So if I just click on success and continue, there is one more pipeline that is available right underneath it. So this one, what it does, it starts executing the production deployment. And if you look at this, so the production deployment 327 is already active, and 329 is getting deployed right now. So by the time the deployment is successfully done, this will be totally disabled and 329 will be active. So vice versa, when you are doing a when you are trying to cancel your deployment stage, I mean, if you want to roll back your deployment, all you got to do is, there are two options of rollback in each ways. So there is manual rollback option, which you can click on this and go for a manual rollback, which will create the container, which will pull the container from the staging stage, and it will create this replica set over here, and you can delete this manually, or else the rollback option, which is already available in the Spinnakar, by failing the stage, you can roll it back all the time. So, right now, if you check this out, 329 is active and the previous deployment is disabled completely. So while this stage is happening, the time it takes to load up, it's basically because it will redirect all the traffic from the previous version of deployment to the current version. So to just check it out. It shows that the deployment part is successfully done. And in the similar manner, you can create multiple pipelines with any cloud providers that is available. For example, if you want to create a pipeline with Azure, that can be created. And many users have raised this query that in Spinnakar, is our credentials, is all of those are confidential or not? With the default Spinnakar installation, it is not confidential. It will be available on your server. If you edit it on the screen, you'll be able to edit. But when you integrate Vault with Spinnakar, all of your secrets will be encoded and it will be stored in the in your Vault repository. So that's exactly what I was gonna demo. So with that, I would like to close. So any questions?